screaming from every mountaintop. Your goodness knows no bounds. Your goodness never stops. Your mercy follows me. Your kindness fills my life. Your love amazes me. Sing because you are good, and I dance because you are good, and I shout because you are good. You are good to me.
Has he been good to you? Hallelujah. Nothing and no one.
Nothing and no one comes anywhere close to you. The earth and oceans deep only reflect this truth. And in my darkest night, your shine as bright as day. Your love amazes me. And sing because you are good, and I dance because you are good, and I shout because you are good. You are good to me, and I'll sing because you are good, and I dance because you are good, and I shout because you are good. You are good to me. With a cry of praise, my heart will proclaim, you are good.
Come on, proclaim that.
You are good. In the sun and rain, my life celebrates. You are good. You are good.
With a cry.
With a cry of praise, my heart will proclaim. You are good. You are good.
In the sun and rain.
You are good. You are good. And I sing because you are good, and I dance because you are good, and I shout because you are good. You are good to me, and I'll sing because you are good, and I dance because you are good, and I shout because you are good. You are good to me.
Hallelujah. We lift our praise to you, God. You worthy, God. You worthy. You worthy, Lord. Hallelujah. Come on, give him praise, somebody.
Your love has brought us out of the darkness into the light, lifting our sorrows, bearing our burdens, healing our hearts. To our God we lift up one voice, to our God we lift up one song. To our God we lift up one voice, singing hallelujah. To our God we lift up one voice, to our God we lift up one song. To our God we lift up one voice, singing hallelujah. Hallelujah, you are the God. Chains have been broken, eyes have been opened, an army of tribals is starting to rise. Death is defeated, we are victorious, you are alive. To our God we lift up one voice, to our God we lift up one song, to our God we lift up one voice, singing hallelujah. To our God we lift up one voice, to our God we lift up one song, to our God we lift up one voice, singing hallelujah, 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 singing hallelujah. To our God we lift up one song, to our God we lift up one voice, singing hallelujah. To our God we lift up one voice, to our God we lift up one song, to our God we lift up one voice, singing hallelujah, 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 singing hallelujah.
Make his praise.
We lift up one voice, to our God we lift up one song, to our God we lift up one voice, singing hallelujah. To our God we lift up one voice, to our God we lift up one song, to our God we lift up one voice, singing hallelujah. To our God we lift up one voice, to our God we lift up one song, to our God we lift up one voice, singing hallelujah. To our God we lift up one voice, to our God we lift up one song, to our God we lift up one voice, singing hallelujah, singing hallelujah, singing hallelujah.
Together and give God praise. We praise you, Lord. You're worthy, God. You're worthy.
Thank you.
Love's like a hurricane. I am a tree bending beneath the weight of his wind and mercy. When all of a sudden I am unaware of these afflictions eclipsed by glory, and I realize just how beautiful you are and how great your affections are for me. Jealous for me. Love's like a hurricane. I am a tree bending beneath the weight of his wind and mercy. When all of a sudden I am unaware of these afflictions eclipsed by glory, and I realize just how beautiful you are and how great your affections are for me. And oh, how he loves us so. Oh, how he loves us. How he loves us so. And oh, oh, how he loves us. How he loves us.
Sing, he loves us.
Yes, he loves us. Oh, how he loves us. Oh, how he loves us. Oh, how he loves. Yes, grace in his eyes. If grace is an ocean, we're all sinking. So heaven meets earth like a sloppy wet kiss, and my heart turns violently inside of my chest. I don't have time to maintain these regrets when I think about the way. Oh, how he loves us. Oh, how he loves us. Oh, how he loves. Yes, he loves us. Oh, how he loves us. Oh, how he loves us. Oh, how he loves us so.
Oh, how he loves us, how he loves us, oh. Yes, he loves us, oh.
Presence here tonight. Thank you for your presence here tonight. Thank you once again. Holy Father,
Holy God,
we thank you for the opportunity and the privilege once again to be able to come into this place and to be able to lift up your glorious and awesome name. Thank you for the privilege. Thank you, Lord. Thank you, Father, for your Son, Jesus, and the cross. And the precious blood that you shed on the cross, that we might have life and life more abundant. Thank you for your amazing grace, your mercies that are new every morning. Thank you for your patience with us, your faithfulness, Lord. Thank you for remaining faithful when we were not faithful. You continue to be faithful. Thank you. Can I get a witness? I will already lift up right now into your hands the families that lost loved ones and children in the tragedy at the school, Lord, back east. Every family, every mother, father, sister, brother that lost somebody in that shooting. We pray your encouragement right now and your comfort for every one of them, Lord. I can't even imagine what they're going through. Such loss. But Lord, we ask you here tonight that you stretch out your hands of comfort and encouragement and love, and during this time of difficulty and pain and mourning, Lord, that you would help every one of these families during this time of loss. And Lord, through it all, I pray in the name of Jesus that if somebody does not know you, that they will come into a relationship with you, that they'll come closer to you, and that your name will be glorified where the enemy meant for evil, Lord, that you'll turn it for good. And through it, Lord, through the stories and the testimonies, souls to come into your kingdom, we pray in the name of Jesus. Souls to come into your kingdom for your glory. For we know your word decrees and declares in Romans 8:28, and we know that all things work together for the good for those who love God and are called according to your purpose. So, Lord, we pray for these right now. We stand in the gap for them, that you wrap your arms of comfort and peace right now, straight from your throne room right now, that surpasses human understanding, to be with every family that lost a child in this tragedy, in Jesus' name. As we continue to worship in this place here tonight, let's continue to worship the Lord in our giving right now. And while we do this, Seaboard, while we, let's take the offering. I want to do it like we do once in a while up here in the altars. So let's bring the offering buckets here. And again, when we do this every once in a while, do this for a reason, because I don't want to become mechanical in our giving. Do you hear what I just said right now, Abed? When we give, it's worship. It's an extension of our worship. And sometimes we become so mechanical during a service, in our service time, when we go through certain things, or, you know, we'll do certain songs or this many songs, and then we move on to this. And I want Lord God to be God. The God Spirit will lead us and guide us. But I don't want us to ever come in this place and become mechanical in our giving. But it's worship. We should, when you come in and you give, it should be like this. Before you even enter this place, as you're driving or even thinking about it throughout the day, a heart of thanksgiving, that number one, that you're now in a position to be able to be a blessing and to be able to give and to understand what it's all about before you didn't even know Jesus. And, you know, all of us were on our way to hell before Jesus, amen. Now we come to church and we have an opportunity now to give so we can impact and reach more for the glory of God. And what a privilege that is. That should be a heart of thanksgiving all the way into the service. And then when we come into service and we're worshiping the Lord, when we give, it should be on our way up and we sow into the kingdom. Again, thank you, Lord. And God, and just, you know, remembering where we were and what Jesus has done in our lives and in our families, and a heart of thanksgiving also for what he's going to do as a byproduct of our giving. Amen. Praise the Lord. So God bless every one of you for your faithfulness. Thank you for your trust. And as you give and you bring your tithes and offerings, especially for people that are visiting, remember, your tithe doesn't belong here. Your tithe belongs to your home church. So your tithe belongs to your home church. That's the storehouse. The storehouse where you're getting fed is your home church. But if you're here visiting and you're here to receive and just get refreshed, if God has put something on your heart to give, that's an offering, then just be obedient to whatever God puts on your heart. And know this, that it's going to reach to help the ministry go forward through the bus ministry, the prison ministry, the breakfast ministry that feeds over some 300 people every Sunday morning. Know that you're sowing in good ground for the glory of God. Amen. So what we're going to do right now is, as we continue to worship the Lord, this is next song. If you have your offering or tithe, just to step out of your seat little by little and just come with a heart of worship and thanksgiving as you bring it up to the altar. Amen. God bless you for your giving.
Feel my heart.
heal my heart and make it clean. Open up my eyes to the things unseen. Show me how to love like you have loved me. Break my heart for what breaks yours. Everything I am for your kingdom's come. As I walk from earth into eternity, heal my heart. Heal my heart and make it clean. Open up my eyes to the things unseen. Show me how to love like you have loved me. Break my heart for what breaks yours. Everything I am for your kingdom's cause. As I walk from earth into eternity. Hosanna, Hosanna, Hosanna in the highest.
Oh, he's worthy of all the glory and all the honor.
Hosanna.
Come on now.
Hosanna.
He's been good to you. If you've been touched by the grace of God and the mercy of God,
Hosanna,
come on, I can't lift it up. He's worthy.
Hosanna,
worthy. Hallelujah.
Hosanna in the highest.
Come on now.
Hosanna. Hosanna. Hosanna in the highest.
All the glory Hosanna. And all the honor. All the glory and all the honor.
Hosanna,
we bless your name in this place.
Hosanna,
we bless your name in
Hosanna
this place.
In the
hallelujah.
Hosanna.
Woo.
Hosanna. Hosanna in the highest. Hosanna in the highest. Hosanna in the highest.
Hallelujah. If you love Jesus in this place and you're thankful for his grace, his amazing grace in your life, come on now. Shout hallelujah.
You're worthy.
He's worthy. Amen. 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 Hallelujah. Just look at your neighbor and say, look at your neighbor and say, he's been too good to me for me not to shout one more time. No. Look at somebody else and say, he's been way too good to me for me to sit here and not shout one more time to the one that has saved me, washed me, cleansed me, turned my life around. He's been way too good. Woo! Way too good. When I was waiting to lose my mind, Jesus. When I was ready to take my life, Jesus. When no one else was there, Jesus stepped into my mess. I said, stepped into my mess and picked me up, turned my life around. If it wasn't for him, I wouldn't even be in this place tonight. Is that just me here tonight? If it wasn't for His grace, His love, His patience, I wouldn't be alive right now. He's a good God. He's an awesome God. And He's worthy of all the glory and all the honor. He's been way too good for me not to shout one more time. God, what a Savior. So what a God, what a Savior. It's been way too good. Way too good. Praise the Lord. Amen. Well, tonight, you're in for a special blessing tonight. I say you're in for a special blessing tonight. Praise the Lord. Before you're seated in the presence of the Lord, just say you're in for something special tonight. Yeah, yeah, and you may be seated in the presence of the Lord. You may be seated in the presence of the Lord. Praise the Lord. God bless every one of you. Welcome. Wow, what a great turnout tonight. I mean, you know, Saturdays usually are, you know, depending on outreach and depending on what, you know, kind of, but I mean, with the weather, I'm thinking, you know, I know like about where I was here with Pastor Roddy earlier, and I mean, it was just coming down. I forget what time it was. And I'm thinking, wow, you know, I mean, it was just like, it was just raining hard. And in Arizona, you know, people kind of get funny when it rains. Amen. Like it, back in Chicago, it's like, you know, it's like, it doesn't make a, I think they go even faster when it's raining. Amen. Can I get a witness? Come on now. You know, I'm talking here, it's like, you know, you just get a little bit of wind and a little bit of, you know, weather here. It's like, oh my goodness, you know, because we don't see it very often. Amen. And so it's like, okay, what do you do exactly? Is it okay to walk outside? Is it okay to, amen, just having fun. Still have to use wisdom and be careful. But you know, but saying all that, really, I mean, what a great turnout tonight. Amen. For, I mean, God bless you for being here tonight. And you're, and I really believe with all my heart, as I just said that earlier, I just felt, you know, just not, I'm not saying like I heard an audible voice, but just in my heart right now that God's going to, you're in for a special blessing for coming here tonight and making it here tonight. Amen. Because, you know, once you're, when you're at home on night, like on days like today, you know, if you have a fireplace, especially, Ava, you get the fireplace going, or if not the fireplace, you get about three blankets, and you got the TV, you know, a good football game, or whatever it might be. You know what I'm talking. It's not necessarily, like, you know, and there's some people that usually come out maybe on Saturday, they're out of here, and it's not about, you know, praise God. I mean, it just it's a little tougher to get out of the house, because this is like, you know, this is sleeping weather. Like, you know, I was talking to a pastor friend about earlier this afternoon, and he was just saying, yeah, I just got up from taking a nap. And I go, yeah, this is the weather. Amen. So anyway, God bless you. God bless you. God's going to bless you tonight. I really do believe that with all my heart. Amen. And being here tonight, and great turnout, great turnout. Tonight, what we're going to do is, actually, I've been a little bit under the weather, just, you know, and I was talking to Pastor Maurice, you know, and how many people know Pastor Maurice from Phoenix World Outreach Center, amen, right down the street from here, and he made himself available tonight, gives me a chance to catch my breath a little bit also, but I do believe he has a word that God's put in his heart for us here tonight that's going to bless us, and he's going to pray for everybody afterwards as the Lord leads, and so you're in for a blessing. Praise God. And I've known Pastor Maurice for since I've been saved, pretty much, you know, from the time, well, Phoenix First Assembly, when we first started off. A lot of us go back to that Phoenix First Assembly with Pastor Barnett. A lot, I think about Pastor Eddie Paul Morris, and I mean, I can just go down the list of Pastor Jesse DiMartino, you know, and I say that, you know, what a man of God, Pastor Barnett, and to God be the glory, and keep him in prayer. I mean, how many ministers have come out of that house that are impacting the world, around the world? I mean, really, I mean, so many people down the list. I mean, I was just watching another program on TV that another person that was in the church there also, and now is, you know, around the world ministering, you know. And so many people from Phoenix First Assembly, and I thank God for that church, and thank God for that season. I think the season between 1995 to about 2002, man. Those were some, I'm not saying there's anything wrong now, but I mean, those were some special, you know, really, I mean, those were some special years, amen. And for many of you, like, you know, Pastor Robert also does the work, leads worship here. He actually was on the worship team back then when Pastor Ritter, we're going back now, you know, Pastor Ritter and was back then. And so many of us learned, I mean, the bus ministry, everything that we do here today, we learned from there. So I'm just very thankful for that church. I'm thankful for Pastor Barnett. Amen. And when you know, keep him in prayer, keep his family in prayer. And he's impacted many people and impacted this city for the glory of God. And I'm thankful for him. Amen. Praise God. One of a kind. Real quick, don't forget, Christmas Eve service is going to be Christmas Eve. Yeah. Christmas Eve service, 6 o'clock, Monday, 6 o'clock, Christmas Eve. You know, starting early so we can get everybody home early for this, be with your friends and your families afterwards. And the kids are going to be ministering. We're going to have drama, music. That's Christmas Eve, 6 o'clock. And then after the next day, Tuesday, which we usually have service, we do not have service on that Tuesday. So Christmas Day, we're not going to be here on Tuesday night. Also, New Year's Eve service. We have service again Monday night at 10 o'clock at night. And we're going to usher in the new year as we've done over the years. And for some of you that have never been part of that, I promise you, your year will never be the same. And we're going to start at 10 o'clock. Praise reports, you know, from the year before. We're going to have some testimonies, praise and worship. We're going to, I'm going to have a word for the new year, 2013, as we always do. And God has always honored that and always blessed that and has always been very accurate over the years. If you rewind the tape, if you go back and pick up every one of those CDs of the New Year's Eve service, the word that has gone forth, God has performed. So I would encourage someone, if you have some of those, go back 2-3 years. I'm telling you, everything that's been decreed and declared has come to pass, and God has been on the money for it. Amen. So we're going to have the new the word for 2013, and then we're going to pray in the year, and we're going to worship. And so what we're doing is we're giving our first fruits with our praise, worship, testimony, in our giving, in the word, in every aspect. And then when 12 o'clock comes around, we're not out, you know, just whatever. But I'm not saying that people are doing anything. There's some people that, you know, somewhere, you know, at midnight at home, something. I'm not saying there's someone doing anything wrong. But what a way to bring in the new year with you and the Lord first. That he gets the first part. So at 12 o'clock, it's not even families. It'll be individually before you get with your family. So at 12, we're not going to sing. We're not going to go 10, 9, 8. At 12 o'clock, we're bringing it in. You giving your heart and praising the Lord and thanking him for what he's done and thanking him for what he's about to do in 2030. So for about 5 minutes between 12 to 12:05, it's just you and the Lord. He gets first part. Amen. And then we'll come together with our families and everybody, and we'll count it down afterwards and have some fun. And then there's going to be some fellowship afterwards with desserts and coffee and things like that after service. So that's this New Year's Eve, 10 o'clock. We'll start at 10 o'clock, and it does get full here. So you want to plan on coming here early to grab seats. Amen. It's one of the most attended, biggest services that we have on New Year's Eve. Remember, the next day, which is Tuesday again, we're not going to be here Tuesday night at 7 o'clock, okay? So the two Tuesday services right after Christmas and New Year's, we will not be here. Those services will be canceled, amen? So please make plans to join us, amen? Who's going to be here New Year's Eve? Amen. And invite some people, invite some friends, amen? It's lots of fun, lots and lots of fun. Don't forget, tomorrow morning, we have service at 10:30. Between 9 and 10, we do have breakfast ministry, free breakfast. So we'd love to have you come and join us tomorrow morning. If you're here for the first time, who's here for the first time? Let me see your hand. Amen. Whole group over here. The whole, is it a whole family, friends, or how? It's a family. I got it. Who do we have? We got a couple people here too. First time. Now, how did you guys find out about the church?
Pastor Maurice is our pastor.
All right, praise God. Pastor Maurice. Well, you guys, God bless you. It's good to have you. Amen. Praise the Lord. And now over here, so this is a whole, I got to come back here real quick. Amen. So who's going to be the spokesperson here? Okay, it's immediate. The hand goes up and the point. They're all like, all right, over here, amen. God bless you. And your name?
Jose.
Jose, God bless you. And why don't you tell us who everybody is?
Okay. This is my wife, Chrissy, my daughter, Katie, my son, Christopher, my son, Shane, my son, Jordan, and that's our friend, Walt, right in the end over there.
All right. Good. Praise the Lord. Give him big God bless you. And then, so how did you find out about the church?
Actually, we heard about the church for a while now from other people that come here. And we looked on the internet, and we thought it looked nice, so we decided to come tonight.
Okay. Praise God. Awesome. Well, good. Praise the Lord. Now, you guys, do you live in close by or in the area or in the vicinity?
Yeah. We live right off 32nd Street.
So. Okay. So, okay. Praise God. Well, you guys, God bless you. It's good to have you guys tonight. Amen. Give them a big God bless you. First time. And for everybody that's here for the first time, we do have a DVD. We have a for you. It's a one of our services, full service, praise, worship, the word. It was earlier this year. And on the way out, if you just stop in the bookstore, and we'll get that out to you in just a way of saying thank you and coming and trusting us with the things of God. Amen. Good, man. Praise God. And you're here for the first time, too?
Yeah.
And your name?
Melissa.
And who and how did you find out about the church?
Soldiers of the Cross.
Okay. Well, God bless you. It's good to have you. Amen. Praise the Lord. Who first, amen. Now, who? No, but hold on. Who's like? It was like right here again. I know because there's multiple. Time wise, I can't get everybody here. Now, how did you find your name?
Daniel.
Daniel. Okay. Praise God. Say hi to Daniel. He's like, man, I wasn't. So, Daniel, how did you find out about the church?
I work at the airport as a lead for the U.S. Airways fuelers.
Oh, you know, I work at the airport too. How do you know I worked at the airport? Oh, he's already told you. All right, amen. So at the airport?
Yeah, at the airport. I just recently gave my life back to God. I walked away from God, and I just recently came back to God, just trying to do my best to serve Him, trying to find a home church.
All right, and so Curtis, at work, so that's how you found out about the church, and he started talking to you about the Lord, and so while he was doing a flight, you were fueling a plane, and there you guys kind of, you know. Okay, through the ministry. So come over here. Okay. God bless you. Why don't you tell him what's going on at the airport?
Right. So about 3 years ago now, maybe 2 years ago, Dave Morris, who used to come to this church, started a ramp revival called R2M Ministries. And Andrew Gillis, he's involved. But every morning we go out to the area that we pray at, and we sit there and we pray every morning. We got food boxes that people can go in. People can go in there and grab free food anytime they want. He was going through a hard time, and I started talking to him. And here he is now, coming to church, give his life back to the Lord. So, and it was actually the word that you gave about 2 weeks ago about going back to the upper room. That got us, because we quit going and praying for a while. And that upper room experience that you were talking about, when I believe it was Lester Summerall punched that lady in the stomach. Smith Willowers. Okay, anyway. But anyway, one of them. But God revealed that to me, that we needed to get back to that. And then shortly after that, we started doing it every night. And that's when he called me up and said he's coming to church.
Praise the Lord. It's good to have you guys. Amen. Praise the Lord. Awesome. Praise God. Well, God bless every one of you. Well, tonight, please, please, please help welcome here tonight. Again, from Phoenix World Outreach Center, which is right over here on Grand, not too far, a couple minutes, 5 minutes down the street over here. Another pastor, church in the hood pastor. Praise the Lord. Hallelujah. Actually, they're right across the street, right next to Teen Challenge here in Phoenix, the Phoenix Teen Challenge. That's where the church is located. I know some of you have been there to the church and been blessed in the past. So please help me welcome tonight Pastor Maurice Chavez. Amen. Praise the Lord.
Can somebody say praise the Lord? Can somebody say hallelujah?
Hallelujah.
I love you guys. I'm just going to stay here. Amen. Praise God. It's so good to be here, and I want to pay honor and respect to the to the angel and prince of the house, Pastor Gus. Amen. People are like, angel? What are you talking about, angel? Well, the Bible talks about in the book of Revelation. It says he sends a message to the angel at Smyrna and Georgia and Connecticut and Chicago. But the Bible recognizes pastors as angels. And so this is your angel. He is your angel. And so I want to respect the angel of the house. Amen? Praise the Lord. I send you greetings tonight from my wife, who is still feverishly trying to get busy, get things ready for our Christmas outreach. We have an outreach that we're doing this year to an apartment complex off of Camelback that's full of refugees from other countries, 14 other countries, Burma, China, Afghanistan, Russia, Iraq, all kinds of places, and Somalia, Sudan, all of these amazing places. And we decided to adopt this place as a mission field, and so my wife is trying to get the remaining things ready for next week. And so she said, please send my greetings, especially to Mama and Papa. Amen. And we got to get together and have some souvlaki. Amen. I just love that stuff. Amen. Praise God. If you are ready to get into the Word tonight, I have a word for you for this church. As a matter of fact, I leaned over to one of my associates here. This is now Pastor Stosh. He's just recently received his credentials. Amen. So proud of him. I leaned over to him and I said, I think I got to preach this message at our church too. Amen. If you have your Bibles with you tonight, let's open to the book of Exodus chapter 17 and beginning at verse 8. Exodus chapter 17 and verse 8. Let me begin my little countdown clock here so I keep track of my time tonight. I shouldn't have any difficulty preaching this message here tonight. Every time I preach here, there's always such an amazing response. It's not like preaching at a Presbyterian church or something like that. So, hallelujah. You get those places. When they said there was a large family back there, I thought to myself, they got to be Hispanic because they come. I can say that I'm Hispanic. So we buy cars with people already in them. So, somos familia. We ready to go. Exodus chapter 17 tonight. Beginning at verse 8. When you got it, say amen. Now Amalek came and fought with Israel in Rephidim. And Moses said to Joshua, choose us some men and go out and fight Amalek. Tomorrow I will stand on the top of the hill with the rod of God in my hand. So Joshua did as Moses said to him and fought with Amalek. And Moses and Aaron and Hur went up to the top of the hill. And so it was when Moses held up his hand that Israel prevailed, and when he sat down, and when he let his hand down, Amalek prevailed. But Moses' hands became heavy, so they took a stone and put it under him, and he sat on it, and Aaron and Hur supported his hands, one on one side and one on the other. And his hands were steady until the going down of the sun. So Joshua defeated Amalek and his people with the edge of the sword. Somebody say amen. Amen. Heavenly Father, we pray tonight that you add your blessing to the word tonight. Lord, I pray that every word that comes out of my mouth be accurate, Lord God. Be skillful, Lord God, in penetrating our hearts tonight, Lord God. May I not speak from flesh. May I not speak from my own knowledge or understanding, but purely through the power of the Holy Spirit in this place tonight. And Lord, I pray that before we even get there, Lord God, that the anointing of the Holy Spirit would begin to fall in these altars tonight, Lord God. May you draw your people to your face, O God, in Jesus' name. Amen. Amen. The title of my message tonight is Who's Holding My Hands? Who's holding my hands? Being a pastor and in ministry, it's easy for pastors to make decisions to put people in leadership purely from desperation. I've been in ministry for over 30 years now. I know it doesn't look like it. You say, Pastor looks like he's 20 years old. Praise God if you think that. Amen. Amen. You're good for my ego. Hallelujah. But I believe that I've been in ministry long enough to know, traveling beginning at the age of 17 to travel and preach as an evangelist, as a young evangelist, to give my testimony of how God had saved me and brought me out of the bondages of suicide and the bondages of the world, being a violent and angry person, angry with life. Even though I came as a pastor's son, I fought with God along the way about being in ministry purely because of what I saw happen to my father in ministry. And having gone into ministry, gone through Bible school, gone into ministry, and now pastoring a church of my own and experiencing the ups and the downs of ministry, understanding that at times we as pastors we're at that place where we want to be able to complete a task and complete a mission and complete the plan of God, that we sometimes become desperate to throw people into ministry. And I look back to myself and I think, I was telling Gus, I said, Pastor Gus, I apologize for saying Gus on our friendship side here. We were talking and I said, God has shown me that you are dragging this church like an anchor through the desert. And this church has, the anchor that you're dragging through the desert is not like the modern anchors, but an old anchor, like kind of like you see tattooed on Popeye's arms, you know what I mean? But the funny thing I told him was that the vision that God gave me concerning this church was that the words were not written in ink, they were not written on paper and taped on, but they were purely molded as a part of the anchor, the words fire and water. And I saw that he was dragging this anchor through a chain around his chest, and he was striving and striving and striving. And I said, God's got a word for this church, and I'm here to share this word with you. And I want to tell you tonight that every great leader needs handholders. They need, in order for the pastor to successfully reach the goal and to achieve the vision that God has put in his heart for this ministry, he needs people to hold his hands. I'm not talking about somebody who comes along and needs to hold his hands. I'm not talking about because he's young and he's handsome, hey, that he needs these beautiful, attractive females to come along. I'm sure there's some that would love to come along and hold his hands. We rebuke that spirit in Jesus' name. If you're here for the pastor, you need to find the door and go home. Amen. This is not the dating game. Handholders. Moving along. Handholders. Amen. I get them. I'm married, brother, and I get them in my church too. Trust me. I get some kooky people. I call them granola bars. They're all, you know what the granola bars are, right? They're fruits, nuts, and flakes. You know what I mean? They all have together with their own sticky stuff. That's what I call it. And they're the ones that come to you and they say, you know, hey, God told me that you're supposed to get married to me. And I said, praise God. When God tells me, then we'll get married. But until that time, God bless you. Handholders. Everybody say handholders. Handholders are people that not only help carry the vision, but help keep the vision alive. And without the visionary, there can be no vision. Come on, somebody. But without someone to hold the hands of the visionary, the victory is only as good as those who are willing to support the visionary. He's not looking for someone to take over the vision. He's not looking for someone to try and clarify the vision. He's looking for someone to hold his hands. Come on, somebody, say, hold my hands. God wants to take fire and water to a whole nother level. I believe in my heart that God has blessed this ministry. I remember when you were in the house and God showed me that God was about to take this ministry to another level. And I believe that this ministry is standing at the threshold of a whole nother level. But God is here to tell you, I'm here to tell you tonight that God is looking for people to hold the hands of the visionary. It gets a little quiet whenever we tell people we're not looking for resumes of preachers. We're looking for resumes. I get people all the time, Pastor, I got skills. If you just put me behind the pulpit, thank you, praise the Lord. But I need some skills at shaking hands. I need some skills at picking up the offering. I need some skills in the nursery. Come on, somebody.
I've got the preaching thing down. I've got the preaching thing down. But what I need help with is I need some hand holders in the house of God. And see, like I said, God wants to take fire and water to a whole nother level. But it's only going to begin when the people begin to start holding the hands of the visionary. There's no need for flaky flakes. God sent me here to tell you tonight that your vision can make it, that your vision can survive, and that your vision can thrive. But what God is looking for is someone to hold the hands of the leader. When the Bible, we read the scripture that says that Amalek came out to fight against Israel, and Amalek fights with Israel. And let me just kind of give you some vision here tonight, the history behind Amalek. Amalek was the grandson of Esau. And Esau was the brother of Jacob, whose name later became Israel. And he was conceived by concubine, by somebody who was not, he was illegitimate. And at times, let me just tell you something, that there are times when things begin to happen where people, they don't get the blessing of the visionary, they don't get the blessing of the father of the house, but they say that, I feel like God is telling me to do something, and I don't believe that the pastor is listening to God right now, so therefore I'm just going to go ahead and start my ministry. And they start up an Amalek in the church. He was illegitimate. He was the result of doing things out of the order of his covering. And have you ever had those times in your life? And as pastors, we understand what it means when we strive against times where we're just trying to keep the body unified. We're trying to keep the vision moving. We're trying to keep things going forward. That we get into that place where we start to deal with people who become the Amalek in the church, where you got to fight with the Amalek rather than carry the vision forward. Let me tell you tonight that whenever there is a striving going on in the church, that the church is held back from the accomplishments of God. I don't care what agenda that you came with. I don't care what God, what you feel that God has called you to do and what God has told you to do. If God had called you to be the vision of this house, then God would have placed you here. But what God has done is God has brought you to sit under a visionary to learn how to carry vision. Stop being an Amalek. Stop being someone who's got your own agenda. Stop being someone who comes with your own ministry title and ministry bishop and apostle and reverend and doctor and teacher and theologian and Krispy Kreme donut. I don't know, but Amaleks were conceived. Amalek was are conceived out of the blessing. And anything conceived out of the blessing is always sure to come back and fight against you. Let me just tell you that there are times when you don't deal with something in your life that your Amalek will come back to fight you. Unless you deal with it. Listen, when God told Israel to go into the promised land, he told them, kill everything in the land. And I know that sometimes people think, why would God allow murder and things to happen? But let me tell you that anytime you permit things to happen in your life, you give it permission to exist. And anytime you give it permission to exist, it comes back to fight with you. And then later, you've got to be able to bring down your Amalek. Let me tell you that your Amalek won't go down as easy the second time as if you confront it the first time. We conceive Amalek thoughts and ideas when we try to do it things our way and not God's way. Because God cannot bless what he's not initiated. I know in your mind you think that God has given you this thought and given you this vision and given you this idea. Great, that's great. But let God bring it, birth it through the visionary. Don't bring it and think that because the visionary doesn't see it that he's not of God. God gives the visionary the vision. God gives the visionary the strength and the power and the anointing to carry the house, and he gives him the power to do that. But any time that you strive because you feel that the visionary is not seeing what God is putting in your heart, then you become an anchor to him and you begin to hold him back from accomplishing and achieving, and you hold back not just the visionary, but the house. I know this is hard, but Amalek, the Bible said, would fight with Israel. Have you ever had an Amalek in your life? Have you ever had I'm going to use some adult language here tonight. So if this offends you, please, I'm not using this in a derogatory sense. But if you've ever permitted something in your life, you're allowing a bastard to happen in you. And I've had, as a pastor, I've had people go on and launch ministries and launch churches without a blessing. And they launch bastard churches and they launch bastard ministries because they don't receive the blessing of the house to be able to start those ministries. And let me tell you, their ministries strive and they strive and they strive, but they don't receive the blessing. And they receive the blessing, they would accomplish and they would achieve and they would be resulting in building and helping to gain victory for the kingdom. But instead, what happens is all the world looks at the church and laughs because we fight against ourselves. Have you ever had an Amalek in your life? Have you ever had an Amalek that you've allowed to and you've given permission to exist in your life? Maybe it's hidden sin in your life. Maybe it's, you know, nobody knows what I'm doing and as long as I'm not hurting anybody. It's an Amalek in your life when you permit it to happen, when you give it permission to exist. See, God is calling this church to hold up the hands, but in order to hold up the hands, the church has to get rid of the Amalek in them. You got to get rid of an Amalek mentality, an Amalek thought process. I know. I had times in my life when I was sitting under pastors and leaders, and I would go to them with vision, and I would say, this is what I think God is telling me we need to do. And they would say, that's great. Now when God tells me, then we'll do it. And they wouldn't do it, and they'd get frustrated. But God was teaching me to kill the Amalek within me. God was teaching me how not to strive with the visionary and how not to strive with my Moses. See, my Moses is my visionary. My Moses is the one that goes to the mountain and he pays the price of being in the presence of God. And all the time, see, we get revelation when we visit other churches. Sometimes there's people that get vision and revelation when they're in the presence of God. But you got to be like Moses, where you get into the mountain to get into the face of God. And sometimes you just got to bask there for a while so that God can show you what he wants and where he wants to take you. And you see, the Bible talks about four key characters. Moses. Everybody say Moses. Everybody say Joshua. Everybody say her, Aaron. Everybody say her. Amen. And amen. Everybody say Moses. Joshua. Aaron. Her. Amen. Want to get that in your spirit? Listen, Moses, God has placed a Moses in this church, and every pastor comes with a Moses anointing because he's leading a multitude. Whether it's one service or two services or three services, the Moses in your life is your appointed leader. It's your appointed pastor. It's the person that you choose to follow into your promised land. It's the person whose God has given a vision. See, when you don't follow your Moses, when you don't follow your leader, you fail to reach your promised land. Instead, you die in the desert. He spent time. See, Moses was an amazing man because he spent time in God's presence. He was the only one of the children. See, Moses was excited about sharing the presence of God, and he called all of the children of Israel over to the mountain, and God comes down to the mountain, and he sits on the mountain, and the mountain begins to tremble and shake, and lightning and thunder and fire come out of the mountain, and everybody said, whoa, 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 you go for us. We're too afraid to go there. You see, and that's what happens when you get this person, this pastor, this anointed, this guy that gets into the presence of God. He gets on his face to seek the face of God and to see, what is it that God wants me to say to the body? What is it that God, where is it that God wants me to take this church so that this church can reach its promised land? It can reach its blessing. It can reach its next level in their life. What is it that God wants me to do? And how is it that God wants me to get there? And you see, and until you pay the price of being on the mountain, you'll never understand what it means to be a visionary. A visionary doesn't just get vision and start walking around and saying, I'm going to build this great ministry. Because until you build the ministry, all you are is a dreamer and not a visionary. A visionary is somebody who gets a revelation, gets a plan, and makes it happen so that they can accomplish all that God wants for the vision. He had a word for God's people. And when everyone else feared going there, he was the man to go there. It's hard to find a leader who's willing to go there. I mean, everybody wants to be there, but nobody wants to go there. You see, there's a difference between being there and going there. Being there, wishing that you could be there, that's one thing. We come to church wishing that we could be there. We taste of the there experience, but haven't paid the price of actually going there into the presence of God. The word comes forth and you receive your touch and your blessing at the altar because of somebody who's gone there into the presence of God. But see, we haven't paid the price of going there. We want to be there, but we haven't gone there. You can always find people who are willing to be here, but few who are willing to go there. You can always find people who are willing to be here, but few who are willing to go. You've got to get to that place in your life where you say, Pastor, if I'm going to hold up your hands, I need to be willing to go with you instead of just coming. See, it wasn't Korah who went into the mountain. Korah wanted to tell the visionary this is how it's going to work. And Korah, because Korah stepped out from under the covering, when he stepped out from under the covering, the ground opened up and ate him. It just munched him like a granola bar. It was it. It was done. It wasn't her. And it wasn't Aaron. It was Moses. If God wanted Aaron to lead the children out of Israel, he would have called Aaron to the burning bush. If it was her, then God would have called her to the burning bush. But it wasn't Aaron or her. It wasn't Korah. It wasn't even Miriam. Miriam had spoken out against Moses, and God struck her with leprosy. And God and Aaron was like, no. It was her. But we need Moses. There can only be one Moses in the house of God. And every time that God is done with Moses, God will raise up a Joshua. And until God is done with Moses, he'll never try to replace a Moses with a Moses. He'll always replace Moses with a Joshua. And Joshua is somebody's amazing because Joshua was raised up under Aaron, under Moses. I mean, he served alongside. He was like an armor bearer for Moses. He learned. And here's the thing that we misunderstand about armor bearing in the house of God. We think that the armor bearers are bodyguards. Oh, I can't get near pastor because he's a bodyguard. He's got his bodyguard. No. This man is my Joshua. He's the one I'm training to take over and succeed me should God move me on, should God be done with me. And listen, you can get as close to me as you want, and I'll hug you, and I'll kiss your kids, and I'll be the good politician that you want me to be. But the problem is that when I have to speak a word into your life, you're not going to like what I have to say. You're not going to like what I'm going to have to do. Let me talk about Aaron was the brother of Moses. And what I love about Aaron is that Aaron represented the values of the old while upholding the vision. Listen, we need some of the pillars in the church. We need people who will stand next to the pastor and not try and tell him how it was. See, that's the problem is that when people begin to bicker and complain about how it was, they begin to die from the plague in the wilderness. It's not about how it was. See, God is not interested in keeping it as it was. God is wanting to continue to move things as it shall be. And that's the difference. Pastor, I remember when we were in the house and we used to do it like this. That's fine for how we used to do it, but that's not how we're going to do it now. He was there when Moses parted the Red Sea. He saw the miracle from the rock. He saw Moses blow it. How many times have I seen? Brother Stosh, he's been with me for a long time now, and there's been times he's seen me mad. He's seen me upset. He's seen me angry. He's seen me cry. I mean, there's been times he's seen my humanity. And listen, that's the one thing that we need to gain perspective on, is that our pastors, just because they have an REV in front of their name, doesn't mean that they are faster than a speeding bullet, that they can lead tall buildings in a single bound. Doesn't mean that when he goes home, he's got a big S branded upon his chest. I know we want to think that. Amen. He's a Superman. He's got to be everywhere. He's got to do everything. He's got to say, pastor this, pastor that, pastor this, pastor that. Listen, the greatest accomplishment that ever happened to me was when I released my errands in my church and began to help me along the way. People who had the ability to be able to pray for the sick. My brother Stosh is my errand in the church. He's the errand that comes along and says, pastor, I'm here for you. Pastor, you know, hey, I'm here to uphold you and uplift you and to encourage you. And there's times when I know that I've got an errand standing next to me that's able to go. And see, listen, sometimes we think, okay, well, you know, pastor, you know, he's just hanging out playing video games in his room. That's what it is. He's just waiting for me to knock on the door. That's what it is. We think sometimes, pastor this, pastor that, pastor this, pastor that. And how many times, one of the greatest words of wisdom that I've ever received was the word that said, release leaders in your church. And that was hard for me. I'm a control freak. I'm going to tell you something. I'm a control freak. If I can control every situation. There was a time when I first came to pastoring. I used to tell, I don't want anything happen, no decisions made, unless they come through me first. But after a while, that got exhausting. The problem was is that when I began to release people to make those decisions, they were making decisions that were contrary to the vision. And what I had to do is go back and pull back the vision from those people, because those people weren't being Aaron, they were being Korah. It's not until I said, listen, as long as this person knows my heart, they know the vision, they know exactly, they're making a, I can say, Pastor Stosh, I'm going to take Friday night off, I'm going to take Friday night off, I don't need to be there to feed the homeless, you're in charge of that. You know, you take care of it. And he knows that in whatever decisions he makes, it's going to reflect on his Moses. Amen? I'm not here to talk about that part of it, but amen. There is something about people who can help uphold the old value while carrying the vision. See, sometimes the young, they try to throw out the old values. I remember when I was young and first starting in ministry, and I came in and I said, you know what? All these old songs, we're going to throw them out. You know, all these old songs, all of them. I don't care. There's power in the blood, and what can wash away my sin? Nothing but the blood. We're going to get rid of all that. We're going to start doing these new modern songs. And it wasn't until I started crossing that threshold of age and wisdom that I began to realize that those songs were written in the times of revival. That I began to understand the old values enough to be able to appreciate them and be able to uphold them, to say, listen, we need a little bit of the old with a little bit of the new. Come on. That's why sometimes it's extremely important. I'm running quickly on time here, so let me try and move ahead here. But you see, we get to that place in our churches where we want a lot of the new stuff. But listen, sometimes, I don't know about you, but I've tried doing the Joel Osteen thing. You know, I'm okay, you're okay, we're all okay, praise God. Now, don't get me wrong. I don't want to speak ill against my brother in Christ. You know, God has anointed him to be that encourager in the body. But something about preaching, just bringing out an old-fashioned fire, something about preaching from an old-fashioned pulpit, something about calling people to old-fashioned repentance and old-fashioned revival, to be able to say, listen, we need to get back onto an old-fashioned altar and seek an old-fashioned God and pray an old-fashioned prayer to bring down an old-fashioned fire and hold on to old-fashioned values and be able to say, God, send down the old fire. So that we see the old fire, what about a new fire? Listen, there's something about the old fire that I like. I'm not putting down the new. We get so hung up on the new that we forget about the old. Today we've got churches who've thrown out the values of theology and the values of standing upon understanding the theological basis of the Word of God, that we've built churches upon a, not on apologetics, but upon apologizing and saying, listen, you know what, I'm going to go ahead and preach you an apologetic message. And we start saying everything from the beginning is, I'm sorry that the church has offended you, and I'm sorry. Listen, the Word of God is the Word of God, and if it offends you, it's meant to cut you and bring you to the altar. Let me move. Aaron, and Hur, you got Hur. And Hur is believed to be the son of Miriam, Moses' sister. And Moses' sister, she was the one that was stricken with leprosy. She was the one that sang on the opposite side. I always like to say she sang on the opposite side of her victory. See, and we say, well, what do you mean? Well, see, had she sung and praised God before the Red Sea opened, God would have defeated the army there. But she sung on the other side after the victory, after her enemy had been defeated. But that's not what I'm here to preach about. Listen, Hur is a representative of the new generation of and the future of fire and water. Hur is the one that represents what God is wanting to do, and not just hold on to the old values, but wanting to do. It's the new blood. I love new blood. When people come in and they got new blood and they say, let's do this. We hired our youth pastor back in March, and he brought in some new blood. He's got vision, and he's got desire, and he's got drive, and he's got purpose, and he doesn't got the old in, but he's got the new. He's come in as my Hur. You know, I've got an Aaron, man. I've got a Hur, somebody who comes in and says, listen, you know, we could do this and we can do that and we can bring in this and maybe we can try that. And instead of looking at him and saying, no, we tried that. We've tried that too, and that don't work, and that don't work, and that won't work. I say, let's give it a go. Let's give it a try. Let's try this. Let's do that. And as a result of that, we've seen our young adults and young people grow. We've got the largest our young people and youth have ever grown. And wherever there are young men, you are sure to have the vitality and vigor. Let me just say that again. Not just young women. I don't want to leave the young women out, but the young men. You see, God has called your pastor to be a spiritual father and to raise up sons. Because you see, the destiny of this church, what? Is this wood? Knock on wood. But Lord forbid that anything should ever happen to your pastor. Lord forbid that anything should ever take place that God would choose to call him home. But what would be the destiny and the future of this church? Unless there's a Hur in the house. Because you see, those Hurs are the ones that they're not coming for the next opportunity to stand behind the pulpit and preach. Oh, pastor, let me preach. The Hurs are the ones that say, pastor, what do you need me to do? Pick up papers? Okay, I'll pick up paper. Pick up the offering? Okay, I'll pick up the offering. Clean diapers? Okay, clean babies' bottoms in the nursery? Oh, okay, I'll do that too. Okay. Listen, Hur could have been out in the battle, but he was where he was needed to be. He was holding on to the hands of his leader. He wasn't trying to get his time in the light. He wasn't begging to hold the staff. He had one job and one job only, and that was to hold up and lift up the hands of his leader. I don't know why God does this to people when he calls people to hold up hands. I don't know why God called me at one time to be an Aaron and a Hur at one time and an Aaron at another time. When I came to Phoenix World Outreach, it was known as Phoenix Inner City Church, and God called me to be a watchman and an Aaron under my father. And my father was the pastor there at the time, but God called me to hold up his hands. And so everywhere he was, I was holding up his hands. It wasn't about just carrying his Bible. It wasn't about getting him water. It wasn't about wiping his brow. It was about making sure that he had time to be in the face of God. And I don't know what it is that today we feel that we don't need leaders. We get people today that I don't need a leader. I can be my own leader. I can be my own pastor. I can be my own shepherd. Let me tell you something. You're only as good as the pot you're planted in. Unless you get yourself to the point where you develop roots, listen, your roots have got to go deep in this place so that you can develop fruit in your life. And not fruit loops, but fruit in your life. You're only as victorious as when you're under a covering in your life. Listen, I'm a pastor. I pastor my church, but my authority will only go as far as that which I'm under the cover of. And so, even though I have a board that I answer to. I have a board that I meet with and I talk with and I discuss with, because I know that if unless I'm under authority, my authority is worthless. I can bind and shandia sikia and tie my bow tie, who stole my Honda, all I want to, but demons will not flee until they know that I'm under the cover of my leader. Come on, somebody. Listen, your victory is in the raising of your leader's hands. The next level is in the victory, is in the raising of your leader's hands. Let me say that again. The next level. How many want to go to the next level? Amen. Hey, all right. Praise God. Look at all the volunteers you have. Amen. How many love Jesus? And we'll be here for the next outreach. Praise the Lord. See, I knew it. I knew you all love Jesus. Amen. Let me tell you why it's important for your leader's hands to be raised. Because raising of the hands, first of all, is a signal to God that you surrender. Why do we raise our hands in church? Because we're volunteering? No, because we're in the place where we say, God, I surrender. And it's not until you surrender that the victory comes in your life. Amen. Praise God. It's not until you surrender that victory takes place in your life. As long as you drop your hands, and saying, I can do this, I can do this, I can work in this. See, the Bible says, I don't know about you, but my Bible says it's not by my might nor by my power. But God says, but by His Spirit, says the Lord. And that's the thing, is as long as I'm putting my hands down, I'm reaching into my well, but the moment I reach up is the moment I'm touching His well, and that's where the strength comes from. That's where the victory comes from. See, I want to tell you to raise your pastor's hands. See, got real quiet, real quick. You got to get to that place where you are saying, you know, Pastor, you don't always have to bug him every 5 minutes. He may not say it, but I'll say it. That gets annoying. It gets annoying after a while. See, how many call this place home for you? If Iron Water is home, it's your home church. See, if it's your home church, then you're going to take care of it like you own it. You're going to take care of it like you own it. You're going to watch out for it. Somebody drops a candy wrapper, you're going to, hey, pick that up, man. This is my house. Instead of saying, Pastor, what do you need me to do? Hoping that he'll say, preach. Yes, sir. Instead, he's going to say, listen, instead of saying, Pastor, what do you need me to do? Just say, just get over and say, listen, I've really got a burden in the outreach. I've really got a burden in the nursery. I really got a burden for greeting people. I love the way you guys greet people. I want to grab people tomorrow and throw them at the door and tell them, listen, I want a gauntlet of greeters here, you know? I love it. I felt like coming in and going like this, you know? Woo! Raise your pastor's hands. See, be faithful in your area of service. If you volunteer, be faithful there. Don't make him wonder where you are on Saturday or Sunday or Tuesday. Don't make him wonder why you haven't shown up to church in a couple thousand years. Don't make him wonder what in the world you've been smoking when you walked in the door. Don't make him wonder what you've been doing behind closed doors. Listen, all you need to do is be faithful, found where you are. And you know what faithful people are? I like to say God is looking for fat people in the house of God. You know what fat people are? Faithful, available, and teachable people. He doesn't need someone to replace him. He needs someone to uplift him. He needs someone to tell him, listen, Pastor, I got your back. No matter where you are, no matter if somebody's talking about you, let me at them. Let me at them. I'll go pray for them right now. I'll go cast the demon out of them. I got your back. I got your back. I've got your back. God is looking for people to have the back, not just the back of their leaders, but the hands of their leaders. Now watch this. Watch this. See, What we fail to realize is that Aaron and Hur, they were holding up the hands of Moses. And what happens is this, is that Moses was doing all that he could to hold up his hands and eventually loses his strength. Pastors lose their strength sometimes. Come on, somebody. But the way that you begin to lift up the hands of the pastor is you begin to be the hands extended. That wasn't a deep revelation. It was just okay. That's all right. People are like, all right. Oh, I thought you were going to give me shouting music there for a minute. Okay. Listen, I've come to realize that my victory is depending on this. And I want to lead you into this place. See, not only do you need to lift up your pastor's hands, but every one of us needs people to lift up our hands. Doesn't mean you're a Moses. You can be a Moses in your own life, in your own minute, your own destiny, your own purposes, but we all need people. Listen, I've heard Pastor Gus say this when I watch Fire and Water on TV. Trust me, I know. Amen. Who you hang around is the prophecy of your future. I see it. I listen. I've taken notes. When I grow up, I want to be just like Pastor Gus. He's my friend. I can say that. But I've come to realize that my victory is depending upon the raising of my hands. 1 Timothy chapter 2, verse 8 says this, I desire that therefore men pray everywhere, lifting up holy hands. Why? Because the victory is in the lifting of the hands. The victory is in every time that I put my hands down, the enemy starts to gain ground. But the moment that I lift up my hands, listen, any time that the enemy comes against you, any time that the enemy tries to defeat you, any time that sometimes you just got to go. You know when I walked into my daughter's room one day, my wife and I had just cleaned up her room. It looked beautiful. I have an 11-year-old child. And we walked into her room, and it was, and I was like, what in the world did she do? I had to step over stuff to get to stuff. I felt defeated at that moment, and I just thought to myself, listen, there's been times in my life when the enemy's come against me. The Bible says that the enemy will come in like a flood against you. But when the enemy comes in like a flood, the Bible says the Lord will raise up a standard against it. Listen, every time that the enemy tries to come in your life, God's not expecting you to fight it in your own strength, because we don't wrestle against flesh and blood. We don't wrestle in the flesh. Sometimes we want to. Sometimes we want to take off our coat, roll up our sleeves, kick off our earrings, kick off our... Oh, I know you didn't. Oh, no, you didn't. It's not how you fight like that, though. The Bible says, listen, God says, do it in His strength. And the way you do it in His strength is that when the enemy is at his strongest point and you think that he's got you defeated, instead what you do is you look him in the eye just like you're about ready to punch him in the face, and you go, don't let the devil keep you back in from coming to church. Don't let him sit, keep you in your chair and thinking, well, I just won't go to church today. I just don't feel like going to church today. That's the day you come to church, and that's the day you lift up your hands and you say, I'm lifting it up. Somebody says, how you doing today? Somebody says, what you going through? You must be going through something. Why are you always doing that? Because God's got the victory. All I'm doing is reaching up and getting a little bit of the... All I want is a little bit of the... I'm going to reach up and touch the Jesus in every which way that I can, because I know that my victory lies in Jesus. The victory of our church lies in me lifting up the hands, my hands, so that I can lift up His hands. Mommy here to lift up His hands. Listen, he's going to do all that he can. The devil will do all that he can to discourage you and defeat you. The Bible says he ain't come. I'm going to read it from my Southern Bible. It says he ain't come but to steal, kill, and beat you down and destroy you. He came out to put a whooping on you. I used to live in South Carolina, so that's how I used to say it in South Carolina. But God says, I've come that you may have life. And that you may have it, I like the way the Amplified says it, to the full, in abundance, in overflow. That's the way God wants to bless your life, and that's the way that God wants to bless this church. See, this church can only go as far as us lifting his hands. You can only go as far in your life as long as your hands are down. Some of you are going to walk out like the Sesame Street commercials. I would like the Sesame. Remember those Muppets that used to walk around on Sesame Street, their hands up like that? Man, I thought about that. That's the way you need to be. Not the yup-yups, but the hands. So I'm getting, I have a grandchild now, okay? Listen, God wants to take this church to another level. Let me just close with a prophetic word for this ministry. God sent me here to this place, and I just been travailing over this. I told Pastor Gus, I said, I'm sometimes an insecure preacher. Sometimes I'll come with two or three sermons in my Bible because I'm not exactly sure how God wants to deliver this. But I believe that this is the word that God has for this church. And I'm going to tell you that God says, listen, the year 2013 is a year of great and miraculous victories in this place. And God says, I will supersede your expectations. Is everything that you, everything he says that you thought in your own measurable ideas, God says, I will blow you away and I will take this church and this leader to a whole nother level. God says, don't just look at him. Don't look at him. God says, don't look at him as just a pastor. But God says, I will establish him as a father and an apostle of ministries to other churches and to other nations and around the world. God says, I have a calling in his life to be global, not just local. God says, listen. He says, my mantle is upon this place, and I've chosen this place to rest my presence here. He says, be careful not to carry false fire. He says, but I've chosen this place that my fire will spread throughout this community, throughout this city, and around the world. He says, and if you don't step into the fire, he says, you'll miss it. You'll miss it. God is challenging you this evening. He says, don't be a hindrance. Be a handholder. Be someone that holds the hands of your leader. The Bible said of Elisha, he was known as the one who washed the hands of the man of God. And because of that, God rested the mantle upon his shoulder, upon the shoulder of Elisha. God cannot bless you with what you have not been faithful with. And unless you're willing to come and say, I am ready to undergird and be a support and a pillar. Some of you have been here from the beginning, and some of you are new and fresh in this place. Let me tell you, put roots here. Because God's about to do something miraculous in this place. Hey, amen. You should be a lot more excited than I'd be up and jumping for joy right now. God's about to do something miraculous in this place. Listen. Last thing, and I'm going to close with this. 2013, he says, there's a doorway. He says, and there's a doorway of decision that needs to be passed through. In that doorway of decision, God says, not only, he says, your leader has already been determining the decision that needs to be made, and it's nothing by which you need to be concerned with or worried. But he says, but every one of you, because he is your Moses, you're standing at that threshold, and each one of you need to make a decision to follow. The question is, will you? Will you do it? Because God says, once you step over the threshold, he says, all heaven is going to break loose in this place. Would you stand with me tonight? Why don't you stand with me? Close your eyes. Would you just begin to lift up your hands right now? Let's begin to... I don't know exactly what... Let me see what time it is, because I don't want to... I want to be respectful. I want to be respectful. Would you just begin to open up your mouth and pray right now? Just begin to pray. 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 Come on. Send your fire, Lord God. Lord, I pray right now that the fire of the Holy Spirit would fall in this place, oh God. Lord, I pray that the anointing that passes, that can be set in unmeasurable portions in this room right now, oh God. And Lord, I pray that there would be some Aarons and some Hurs to raise up in this place right now. And Lord, tonight we're going to pray. We're going to lay hands upon those that are ready to take that step into the next level, Lord God. Those that are ready for that anointing to fall in their life, Lord God. Those that are ready for God to do something miraculously and powerful in their life, Lord God. Lord, we're gonna see eyes open. We're going to see hearts broken, Lord God. We're going to see lives changed tonight, Lord Jesus. I need some people, I need some on-fire saints to lift up their voices in this place tonight. Come on. Come on. Some of you need to raise your hands. Some of you need to raise your hands. Let that be a sign, a symbol of what is going on right now. Hallelujah. You need to, right now. You say, Pastor, I'm ready, I'm ready, I'm ready, I'm ready. I want the anointing of service in my life. I want the anointing of breakthrough in my life. God, I've been struggling with victory in my life, and I know that God has a victory for me tonight. If that's you tonight, you say, I need a victory in my life, and I want to be able to step up and get to that next level tonight. If that's you, I want you to quickly stand, step out of your aisle and come stand up here tonight. God's about to do something great in your life tonight. Get to these altars tonight, would you just lift up your hands and begin to cry out to God? No apologies, no apologetics. Just begin to cry out to God tonight. Come on, come on, come on. Touch the hem of his garment tonight. Touch his presence. Get face to face, eyeball to eyeball tonight. God is about to do something miraculous in this place. Hallelujah, 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 hallelujah. God is looking for some Aarons and some Hurs. God is looking. Some of y'all need to break your Amalek tonight. Some of you have an Amalek in your life. You need to break it and kill it tonight. Come on, cry out, cry out, cry out, cry out, cry out, cry out tonight. Hallelujah. In the name of Jesus, in the name of Jesus, in the name of Jesus. Hallelujah. Lord, we need you. 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 Pour out your spirit in this place, oh God. Pour out your spirit in this place, oh God. In the name of Jesus. Oh, hallelujah. Praise the name of Jesus. Hallelujah, Lord. Hallelujah. Hallelujah, Lord. We need you. Pour out your spirit, oh God, right now. In the name of Jesus.
Lord, I love you.
Lord, I just love you.
Fresh fire. Fresh fire.
Hallelujah.
Fresh anointing. Fresh anointing. In the name of Jesus.
Hallelujah.
The Lord in this place. I told you, you're in for a special blessing tonight. God is moving in this place. Don't be in a rush. Don't be in a rush. I want to encourage you in this place. Pastor Maurice didn't even know, you know, the last couple weeks we've been talking about cover, happy, 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 all about unity and working together. And he has no idea the last couple weeks of the messages. We have new people that are coming. We have people that have been here for a while. We're in it together. No one gets left behind. When someone's down, we pick them up. When someone's down, we pick them up. He mentioned Elisha when he ministered and he served, when he was serving Elijah. The Bible, when Elijah went to be with the Lord, Elisha, when he served and was under that covering, he did twice as many miracles as his mentor Elijah. When we serve, the Bible says the greatest is a servant. And your gift will make room for you. Don't ever get discouraged that, oh my God, I'm going to miss it. If your heart's in the right place, you will never miss what God's called you to do. When you do it the right way with the right heart and you're doing it unto the Lord, you will be exactly where you need to be in God's timing. your gift will make room for you. Just keep doing the right thing, be patient, and you will not miss it. I promise you, if your heart's in the right place, you will never miss God's will for your life. Amen? Just lift up your hands, and just worship Him in this place. This is awesome. This is awesome. God's presence is strong in this place tonight. My God.
Fresh anointing right now. Flow. There it is. Be filled. Fresh anointing. God said, you didn't come here to be a spectator. God said, I brought you to this place tonight, He says, so that your eyes could be open. God said, I've brought you to this place, He says, because I've given you serving hands and serving feet, says God. He says, come into this place with a joyful heart, says the Lord. In the name of Jesus, right now, I break the spirit of grief. I don't know why I sense that so strong. I break the spirit of grief right now and loose in Jesus' name. Anointing, flow in Jesus' name. Anointing.
Hallelujah.
a smile on your face. He says, God said, this is let's lift up our hands. Let's lift up our hands. As we... Hallelujah, Lord. We thank you for your presence. Thank you for your presence. Thank you for breakthrough. Thank you for liberty. Thank you for healing. Thank you for restoration. Promotion. As we together move forward, together, together, no one being left behind. Together we move forward in the name of Jesus. Hallelujah.
I exalt thee.
sing praises to your name. Oh Lord, praises to your name. Oh Lord, for your name is great and greatly to be praised. I sing praises to your name. Oh Lord, praises to your name. Oh Lord, for your name is great and greatly to be praised.
Right now, fresh anointing, Father God. I break the spirit of bondage over you right now.
guys, stretch out your hands up here. Also, don't be, we're going to get everybody here in a second. Just, this is the family that was in the back. We're going to do a corporate thing here. Amen. Praise the Lord. Amen. Just stretch out.
Jesus, right now.
And the honors, Lord, we lift our hands in worship.
God says, it's time to come out of hiding. I don't know why he says hiding, but the word hiding is coming into my mind. And he says, it's time to come out of hiding. He says, because whatever it is that has hit you, it hits you like a rock in your heart. And God says, it's time to come out of that hiding place. He says, and God says, it's time to come into the holy place. Right now, God said, I'm about to renew the fire. There was a time when you had a fire within you and you would serve with fire in your heart. He says, but something caused you to dig your heels in and stop. And God said, right now, I'm breaking the curse that was spoken over your life right now in the name of Jesus. Lord God, loose the anointing. Loose the anointing, Lord God.
Lord, we lift our hands in worship as we lift your holy name. You deserve the glory and the honor.
Turn direction, God. Lord,
we lift our hands.
Don't listen to the voice of the enemy anymore. Stop letting his voice in your heads.
So great, there is no one else like you.
Let God heal you right now. Let God heal you right now.
There is no one else like you, for you are great. You do miracles so great. There is no one else like you.
God is giving you a burden in a heart. He says, you have a gift.
There is no one else like you.
He says, you touch people in ways. He says that people, they come to you and they ask for wisdom. He says that wisdom that flows through you is not is of me. He says it's a gift from me, God said. But sometimes he says you've allowed your bitterness to flow through you instead. God said, heal you right now. Touch, be broken right now in the name of Jesus. It's loosed. Father God, I break the spirit of bitterness in the name of Jesus. I break the spirit of anger and rage, Lord God. I break the spirit of unforgiveness in the name of Jesus. And I loose freedom and joy in the Holy Spirit right now. In the name of Jesus. In the name of Jesus. Let that person go. Let him go. Let that person go. I see there's one particular person. There are others, but this one particular one that God said has affected you the most. He said, and he says, and you hang on to them. Let them go. Let them go, says God, right now. In Jesus' name, joy, 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 right now, joy. you're the turning point in this family. He says, you always seem to be the one that remains the most positive of everybody. Am I right in that? Is it right? Okay. I want to make sure I'm right. I don't want to be shooting off the hip here. God says, I'm going to take you to another level tonight. As God said, because of your faithfulness. This is when others have wanted to give up. He says, you continue to tell me. Maybe we just need to trust God. Maybe we just need to keep on offering the positive worship. Even when everybody else is preaching down, God says, don't let that discourage you. God says, I've got
hope for the glory.
God says, I've got hope for you.
And the honor. Lord, we lift our hands
in Jesus. God said, I've given you a gift.
As we lift Jesus, your holy name. For you are great. You do miracles so great. There is no one else like you. There is no one else like you. For you are great. You do miracles so great. There is no one else like you. There is no one else like you.
Awesome tonight. Hallelujah. 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 We bless your name in this place. We bless your name in this place.
to you.